series, and this series is called Resistance as Practice, Acts of Anti-Racism Through Architecture and Planning. And the event series is hosted by Dalhousie University's Faculty of Architecture and Planning's Equity, Diversity, and Inclusion Committee. And we're hosting it in partnership with the SHIFT Conference. And I want to start first by acknowledging that Dalhousie University is located on Mi'kma'ki, the ancestral and unceded territory of the Mi'kmaq, and that we are all treaty people. I also want to introduce our elder in residence, who is Jerry Muska LeBlanc. She's gonna be giving us a blessing to begin Dr. Mindy Fullilove's talk today. And Jerry is a proud woman from the Nakaway First Nation. She's a mother, a grandmother, and great-grandmother. And Jerry's traditional name is Red Eagle Woman, and she's a Bear Clan knowledge keeper and a pipe carrier. Jerry's received the Queen's Diamond Jubilee Medal for her work in both social justice and employment equity. And in December of 2015, she took on the role of coordinator of the Elders in Residence program here at Dalhousie. So today, I just want to say, you know, we really appreciate you being here, and thank you so much for coming to share your knowledge, Jerry.
I think she's been having some troubles connecting. I just sent her another link, so hopefully Jerry will join us shortly.
Okay, well, maybe in the meantime, I'll give some background about this series. So this lecture series, our engagement with racism really comes at a critical time because, you know, we have Black Lives Matter protests that have once again rallied around the call that Black and Indigenous lives and others of communities of color are not expendable. Also calling for the reform to law enforcement and other public institutions. It's also a time where planners and architects have to reflect on how our practices have aided in the loss of life and property for some of those same communities. So for us as designers and as architects and as planners, this really means questioning how designed and planned spaces are embedded with power structures that tend to stratify our society, and also how sometimes practitioners can be implicated in this. And we also want to acknowledge in this series that this isn't really a new conversation or a new area of analysis, and that communities of color have continually engaged in this kind of work through some of their daily experiences in urban spaces, and also by resisting oppressive regimes and policies. Also, the fact that racialized communities have developed some of their own planning and design practices in cities when they haven't been heard by the faces of power. So this lecture series is really about building on some of these powerful responses to racialized violence by presenting the work of practitioners and activists and also scholars, of course, who've pursued these kinds of acts of anti-racism as the central focus of their work. So we're really trying to make connections and kind of find synergies between some of these diverse practices that'll help provide some new insights for how we pursue racial justice in our cities. So that's kind of where this lecture series is kind of centered. I'm wondering, has Jerry had any luck getting on the call? Oh, Jerry is here. Okay. Well, then in that spirit, I want to turn it over to Jerry, who will do the knowledge sharing for this event.
Thank you very much. And I apologize. My computer, for some reason, wouldn't let me on as soon as I get on here. And I started at 1:45. So my name is Jerry Muska LeBlanc, and I'm the coordinator for the Elders in Residence at Dalhousie. And I've been given the honor of saying a blessing for your event that's going on here. But before I say my blessing, I would like to give you a very short teaching on what land acknowledgements are and why we have them. And you might wonder why, and I'm sure a lot of people wonder why we have land acknowledgements. But a small but important first step in the reconciliation process is to acknowledge the original people and and their territories, the territories that they were given to protect and to live on. There are other reasons we should use to acknowledge traditional territories. One of them is to recognize the history and legacy of colonialism and to move forward towards reconciliation. Another reason is to demonstrate awareness of Indigenous land rights and to move towards establishing respectful relationships with Indigenous people. In Nova Scotia, the people and territory we acknowledge are the Mi'kmaq. I'm not Mi'kmaq, I'm Anishinaabekwe from Kisikoos, and I thank the Mi'kmaq for allowing me to practice my traditions on their territory. So even though I'm an Indigenous elder, I must acknowledge territory and the people who live here. I'm going to say a prayer, and you've probably heard me say this before, but before I do the blessing, I want to let you know that I pray to my creator. Everyone prays to who their own superior being. So I invite you to listen to the words that I say, pray with me, but talk to who it is you talk to when you typically pray. Now, before I get started, you're going to hear me say a few words at the very beginning of the prayer. The words will be in my language. And the reason they're in my language is because I have to let the Creator know who I am and why I'm here. Great Spirit and good Creator of all things, Anansikwa, and Disney Cosmos Gwiginukwe, Magwa Dodem, Nakawe Anishinaabekwe, Kisikus, Gizolk, Kachiminitu, Great Spirit, we honor you with this prayer. We acknowledge your gifts of life and knowledge. We direct our attention to the life forces on Mother Earth. We give thanks for all we have, our food, our water, air, shelter, and so many beautiful beings who are our brothers and sisters. We give thanks for the gifts of Two-Spirit people and the teachings they share. We give thanks to the rivers and streams which supply us with water and to all herbs which furnish medicines to help us cure our illnesses and diseases. We give thanks to the moon and stars which have given us their light when the sun is gone. We give thanks to the sun that has looked upon the earth with a beneficent eye. Creator, we give thanks to those who have given of themselves to ensure we continue to live the good life we lead. We give thanks for the many people in this gathering who are willing and eager to help those who are not treated with respect and courtesy. Gizolk, we ask the actions that are taking the lives of innocent people be stopped. We ask that we all live according to the directions given to us at birth. Creator, we ask that your spirit dwell within each one present and to help them listen with open hearts and minds as they listen to the teachings we share. We pray that we can work together to find ways to support each other. Chiminitu, we pray for the good of our nations, communities, our families, elders, leaders, and medicine people. We pray for those who give of themselves to protect the freedoms we enjoy. Great Spirit and good Creator, we ask these things in a good way so that the steps we take will become the path of peace for future generations. All my relations, Sit Nok Mak. Thank you very much for listening to the prayer. Before I let you begin your lecture, your discussions, I want to share with you why we say we are all treaty people, because you probably wonder that too. even though you and I didn't sign any treaties, our ancestors did. Your ancestors, my ancestors. The treaties that were signed were based on peace and friendship, and the people those treaties affect are still here, you and me. If you aren't aware of treaties signed on the territory you're at, because I'm sure we're not all on Mi'kma'ki, I'm sure we're in different parts of Canada, that might inspire you to have post-conversation meetings or post-meeting conversations with traditional First Peoples. Putting yourself in the vulnerable spot and taking on the fear of criticism in order to learn something can be very, very powerful motivator to learn more. So with that in mind, I thank you very much for listening to me. And if it's okay, I want to stay and listen to what's going on here.
Oh, absolutely. Thank you so much, Jerry, for being here today to share your knowledge. And we're so glad that you're gonna stick around for the lecture. We always really enjoy having you. So thanks again for coming.
Thank you very much.
So before I turn it over to Isioma to introduce our speaker, Mindy Fullilove, I just want to ask that everyone be sure that their microphone is off. I also want to say that we're going to end with a Q&A session. So think about if you want to ask a question either to Mindy directly afterwards, or you feel free if you want to type your question into the chat and we'll get to as many of them as we can. So now I want to turn it over to Isioma, who is an MArc student here at Dow, to introduce our speaker.
Thank you. All right. We're happy to have Dr. Mindy Fullilove, who is a social psychiatrist who explores the ties between environment and mental health with her colleagues at the City Research Group and University of Orange. Mindy explores the consequences of social fractures for our society and our health and six ways to reconnect the broken parts. She received her bachelor's degree from Bryn Mawr College and her MS and MD degrees from Columbia University. She completed a residency at New York's Hospital Westchester Division and Montefiore, and is board certified as a psychiatrist in psychiatry. Prior to joining the new school full-time in 2016, Mindy taught at Columbia University and was a lecturer at Parsons. She has published numerous articles and six books such as From Enforcers to Guardians, a public health primer on ending police violence with Hannah L.F. Cooper, Urban Alchemy, Restoring Joy in America's Sought-Out Cities, Root Shock, How Tearing Up City Neighborhood Hurts America and What We Can Do About It, and House of Joshua, Meditation on Family and Place. And of course, her most recent book, Main Street, How a City's Heart Connects Us All, which dropped fall last year. I'm glad you can join us and I'm glad you can speak to us. Thank you.
Thank you so much. Thanks for that beautiful prayer and land acknowledgement, and thanks for the introduction. And it's a pleasure to be with you this evening. And I would like to share my screen and take you through some slides and little movies. So I think you can see that. Everybody can see that, right? Great. So this overarching theme of resistance as practice is a lovely theme. And I'd like to tackle it from my perspective as a social psychiatrist. And I'd like to just first say that, you know, there are four points I want to get to, which you can see here. But before I dig into that, I want to talk about what does that mean, my perspective as a social psychiatrist. So when I was a resident at New York Hospital Westchester Division, a very famous psychiatrist, George Engel, published a paper called The Biopsychosocial Model in Clinical Practice. And this is his diagram. Basically, his theory was that interior to the human being, there are many systems, but the person is also located in social systems of the family, the community, and really literally the globe. And that medicine, he said, focuses really on the person and the things that are interior to the person. This is the biomedical model. But he said, but you can't really understand the illness unless you look beyond what's going on interior to the person. You have to understand the social systems in which you find the person. And that's my discipline of social psychiatry, looks at this issue of how is the person located in this nested hierarchy of social systems. And this is, I just want to say as a social psychiatrist, this is challenging work for a psychiatrist because we're basically trained in the biomedical model. We have some training in couples therapy and family therapy, but not really any training in how do cities work. So how do nations work? That's like beyond us. And so as part of undertaking the work that I have done for many decades now, one of the things I had to do was develop a way to learn about cities, which I did via a sort of many year tutorial with French urbanist Michel Cantal Dupar. So I would go to Paris every year for some weeks or months, and he would take me around and teach me. So that's basically how I came to have some awareness. But foundational to when I'm looking at cities is that I'm looking at cities basically as how are they holding the population. A fundamental proposition in social psychiatry is that populations have to be organized in some way. And the word for this is integration, and then its opposite is disintegration. And this is based actually on a foundational study that was done in Canada by Alexander Layton, who said that he thought that a community that was well integrated would have all of the characteristics that you see. Among them, really importantly, shared sentiment. So everybody in the community would see a flag and have the same reaction to a shared flag. At the other end, he said, as communities fall apart, we lose the concern for the other, this commitment to the collective good or the we, as he defined it. And people will become concerned only for themselves. And in that situation, you would have higher rates of illness and social pathology, and the illness would be more difficult to manage. His proposition was, and this is a startling proposition, that a rich person in a disintegrated community will have poorer health than a poor person in an integrated community. And it turns out that there's more and more empirical support for this proposition, which seems startling. The idea is that if you have wealth, you're protected against everything, but that's not true. What's really protective is that you are in a functional social system. We were looking at this model and collection in Harlem, New York in the 1990s. And listening to people there tell us what had happened in their neighborhood, what we became clear about was that there had been a transition from a neighborhood that was much closer to the model, much more integrated, to something that was approximating the collection, where social ties had been torn apart and people no longer had that sense of we. They had lost the way to work together. The point of this is that in when we were looking in the 1990s, there was a very important paper that pointed out that Black men in Harlem had a shorter life expectancy than did men in Bangladesh, which was just horrifying. And so we were really trying to understand the collapse of health. And what we learned from people's stories was that the health, the community had collapsed under the pressure of federal, state, and local policies. So things that had been done by our government to tear the neighborhood apart and that had pushed it from being a model towards being a collection. And at the bottom, in this small model that we developed, that we proposed in the 90s, we observed things that made no sense to us, and we called that nonsense. So now I'd like to go to, that's sort of how I approach what I'm going to talk about, and is sort of with this idea that if we want to have a healthy society, what you have to have is social connections among the people in the society. So the first of the four topics I want to talk about is American, and of course by American I mean US, and I apologize to the neighbors to the north and to the south, Jim Crow capitalism. But it's really fundamental to the United States, which is a capitalist nation, that is also a Jim Crow nation. And so what is Jim Crow? And how is that important? So the ground rules of this system of American Jim Crow capitalism are that it's always driving for maximum profit and seeking to eliminate constraints. In other countries, there are constraints on capitalism and they balance the need of the society with profits. But that's not true in the United States. It is always exploiting race. In fact, it invented race to divide people and other divisions so that it can undermine the power that working people and their allies would have if they could get together. And most terrifyingly, American Jim Crow capitalism is always willing to play the odds that profits can be maximized while without courting disaster, that you can get all the money and get out of town and it won't collapse. So this is a picture of one of the major steelworks in Pittsburgh, major steel town in the United States. And here in the background of this picture is a hill that's, and on that hill is an African-American community called the Hill District. In this map, which was looking at segregation in Pittsburgh, you can see that the inside the red circle is sort of the tip. The colored area is the segregated area. And that tip is called the Lower Hill, and it becomes important because that's the area that gets cleared by urban renewal. So the segregation of American life is fundamentally what Jim Crow is. Jim Crow gets established, it really gets written into law in the period between 1890 and 1910. And over that period, there's an accumulation of separations. So separations in transit, separations in water fountains, separations in hospital waiting rooms, separation in where you'll be hospitalized, separations in schools, separations in neighborhoods. These all are layered one upon the other over time. And if anybody got to see the movie, The Help, which is about 1950s, one of the things that's going on in that movie is that a white woman is offended that her black maids would use her toilet or use the same toilet she used. And she wants to pass a bill that people would have to have a toilet outside their house for their black maids. But and what's instructive about that is that that is the logic of how segregation proceeds. So there's segregation in the water fountain or segregation in the public toilets. And then somebody comes home and says, wait, I want segregation in the toilet in my house. So that is how it was elaborated, and it resulted in this really dividing of the nation. So that becomes a fundamental structural layer of American life. Other things come on top of that. So in the late 1930s, during the Depression, the federal government wanted to support the banks and give them guidance about where to invest their money. And so they launched a program to rate cities. And the cities were rated basically in a 2x2 table of white, non-white, new buildings, old buildings. And this creates four zones. The green is white people in new buildings with restrictive covenants, meaning undesirable racial elements, as they were called in the documents, could not infiltrate the neighborhood. Blue are white people in less new buildings, perhaps with less restrictive covenants. The yellow, again, is in this stratification, the next step down. And so foreign-born and immigrants, some black people, not so old buildings. The red areas are all the undesirable racial elements. So black people, Hispanic people, Chinese people, Jews, immigrants in old buildings. Now these maps are called redlining maps. And I just want to say, this is like a psychiatric thing, but I have to say this. I just want you to think, do you see a red line on this map? And that's a non-trivial question, because in talking about it as a redlining map, we emphasize the red areas, but in fact, what's being stratified is the whole city. And it's directing investment, and it's directing investment to green areas and blue areas, which are basically fully developed in the 1930s American city. The consequence of this map is that investment is not going to go into American cities. It's going to go into American suburbs. And so these maps are really codifying the abandonment of the American city, which is going to be the dominant structuring force of our cities for the next 50 years. So the second thing that is fundamental about these maps is that they propose a paradigm, which is that you should invest in new buildings for white people, however you define white, however you define new. And don't invest where you have undesirable racial elements who are poor. And that paradigm is driving all of American architecture and planning. So we really have to understand that this paradigm, which was instituted in the late 1930s, is in the US what's going on. Now, this paradigm is both about race and about class, because American Jim Crow capitalism, you can never separate race and class from one another. The disinvestment in the Hill District takes many forms, but this is what it looks like in the late 1990s. So it has fallen apart. And it's fallen apart. So these vacant lots that you see were not there. In the 1950s, they come from contagious housing destruction, which has destroyed them. They're boarded up buildings that have been abandoned. The population has collapsed. And what was once a very vibrant neighborhood, truly close to the model, is now sinking into really dysfunction. Now, resistance is a constant part of the story of American Jim Crow capitalism. And I thought I would just talk a little bit about Reverend William Barber, who with Liz Theo Harris, Reverend Liz Theo Harris, is the head of the Poor People's Campaign, which is one of the most important civil rights campaigns going on in the United States at this time. And I thought it would be very useful to show a short film of their work. But what I want to say about it is that the United States, under this influence, this divide and conquer strategy of American Jim Crow capitalism, is a highly fragmented nation. And Reverend Barber has invented what he calls the Moral Fusion Coalition as a strategy to unite the fragments. And because also Christian nationalism is part of the right-wing strategy, he's working to reclaim a language of the moral and constantly center the problems of poor and low wealth people. So I'm gonna stop my PowerPoint for a sec. And show you this video, which is made by the film company Rumor. Can you hear it, Lisa?
You see, our opponents, their strategy is always one of division. The idea of community to us is we. The idea of community to them is them versus us. And it's a strategy. They've tried and it's worked in the South, especially for a long time, but a change has come. We come here every Monday to say, if you mess with the poor, you mess with all people who care about justice. If you mess with voting rights, you mess with all people who care about justice. If you mess with education, you mess with all people who care about justice. And when you mess with women's health, you mess with all people who care about justice. And I didn't have any physical sisters, but I got a whole lot out here. So when you mess with one, you actually unify us and you bring us together. You need to be around some people that still believe in the possibility of us being one people. I needed to come to church on Mara Monday.
Where it gets really real. She just gave the compliment that makes those who are narrow-minded fear the most. And that is when this sister looks at me and says, amen, brother. And I say, right on, sister. And Dr. King said one time, we may have come over here on different ships, but we all in the same boat now.
Thanks.
My, my. So depressed when I heard what this legislature thinks of me.
But I came last week.
But I came last week.
And I was inspired.
And I was inspired.
And I'll come as often as I need to.
And I'll come as often as I need to.
So I'm going to go back to my PowerPoint. I think I am. So just to, the Moral Monday protests were the predecessor, the immediate predecessor, where Reverend Barber put together these concepts of moral fusion coalition with a local activist in North Carolina. But he's now taken it to the national stage, and it's become, as I said, the most important civil rights movement at this point in the United States of America. On election night, November 6, 2020, the Poor People's Campaign held a prayer meeting. And one of the things that Reverend Barber said was, we don't know who's going to win this election, but we do know that tomorrow morning, there will be 140 million poor and low wealth people in the United States of America. And so this becomes the voice of the resistance. And the voice of the resistance takes different forms in different times, but it has always been present, and it's present for all the movements against injustice, against what Jim Crow capitalism is doing to people in the United States. But American Jim Crow capitalism is greedy, and it wants all the profits. It doesn't want to share, and hence that's the dynamic of our system. And so anytime a movement gets started and begins to gain strength, as the Star Wars people said, Empire Strikes Back. So how does this happen? It happens in many kinds of ways and has in our history taken very different forms of union busting, forms of anti-communism, forms of racism. Racism is a core strategy of dividing people. Anytime a movement gets going that's interracial, racism is heats up. But they have a whole panoply of strategies. But I think Margaret Thatcher's comment neoliberal ideology started to take hold, is that no such thing as society is really quite an extraordinary statement from a leader of a nation, where she said, people think government should help me, but there's no such thing as society. There are individual men and women, and there are families, and no government can do anything except through people, and people look to themselves first. For me as a social psychiatrist, as I've already made clear, there is society And the health of all of us depends on the integrity of the society. So the leader of a government saying there's no such thing as society and I don't have to take care of it is terrifying. But the important thing is that it sets in motion the shedding of all the things that government does for people. So the United States went into the COVID pandemic missing tens of thousands of public health workers because that aspect of government had been defunded. In my opinion, neoliberal ideology, which said there was no society, took the gamble that we could create a collection just of individuals, everybody taking care of themselves, but without acknowledging that a collection, when that is the stage of social integration, what you have is the state of nonsense. And certainly in the past several weeks, we've had a profound demonstration of what happens when nonsense is not simply in a neighborhood that's terribly distressed, but has moved both geographically across a nation and socially up the social hierarchy. A nation in the grip of nonsense, as the Department of Homeland Security announced today, is at risk of terrorism, homeland terrorism, not from people outside our society, but from people within our society, because we've lost the sense of we've lost the sense of shared sentiments. We don't salute the same flag anymore. This kind of fracturing creates a state, a particular state of society, of how people feel when we're in a state of nonsense, which is anxious and depressed and angry. And this is a very dangerous position to put a society into. So part of what is the challenge here is that we need to move back towards the we, but let me just go back to this diagram for a second. In a highly fractured society, it's very far from we, like really realistically. People have, social bonds have been broken. There are many, many ways in which we have fractured our society geographically and socially. And so saying, okay, we're gonna put this back together, or we need to remake the we need to have unity, is a lovely goal, but actually getting to unity has to overcome this realistic state of fracture, which is in the built environment, it's in the social environment, it's in the political environment. It's in every part of our daily lives. So this is necessary, but very difficult. Hence the importance of the concept that Reverend Barber has articulated, that we can build moral fusion coalition. We can take the little groups and put them together. Now, part of what I've worked on a great deal is what people call the psychology of place. I would say it's very foundational to the work I've done. And one of the things about the psychology of place, which brings in the magic art of tidying, which is been, you know, you can write a book about how to clear clutter and make millions of dollars. Why is this a magic art? And what does it have to do with getting us out of the trouble that we're in? Is that human beings and all animals, and I think plants as well, have a sense of place that's built into our bodies, built into us. The sense of place is very complicated. Sense, it's not like hearing, seeing, it's a combination of all of those. It's a meta sense. But as that sense develops, as we mature and we are in different places and we function with different groups of people, we come to have a sense of right and wrong of a place, how we want a place to be. And this is a place not only at the level of our house, but the level of our neighborhood, of our city. People seek to make places that fit their needs so that places are always evolving and changing. One of the wonderful books, which I'm sure many of you who are architects and planners know, is Stuart Brand's How Buildings Learn, which is sort of, when the building is finished, when the architects are done and the family moves in, they immediately start to change it because as soon as you make a place that suits what you need today, something changes. You have a new baby, or baby moves out, or shelter in place orders. And then everybody's like, wait, I have to change my place. And we have heard so many stories of how people have had to change their homes in order to tolerate shelter in place, that we've really had a demonstration of how this need to make places fit our needs is so important. And so tidying is magical because it satisfies this search for a fit. Now, interestingly, as soon as a place fits us, this is Stuart Brand's point in How Buildings Learn, it no longer fits us. So we are always behind, and hence we're always wanting to fix. And so we preference fixing over appreciating. That we are preference complaints over gratitude. People do this. People will have, the only time people like their house in the United States, people I've talked to, is when they fixed it up just before they sell it. So it's perfect, everything is settled, they're really happy. They had to do all the little odds and ends that they never did. And they're like, wow, the place is great, I really love this place, and they sell it and move. I think that's the only time. So I just wanted to give you an example from Stuart Brand's book, which is in Halifax. How do you like that? So as he points out, Canada's National Museum of Immigration exemplifies a building which learns, in his sense that it adapts to fit new needs. He says it's a low road building by his definition. Without fundamental alterations to its basic structure or materials, it began as a bleak bulk cargo warehouse, then an ocean liner terminal, an immigration building, and finally a national museum, the Canadian equivalent of Ellis Island. So the idea that you make a building and then it changes over the lifespan of the building, this is really what's going on in tidying. We are trying to say, how do I make this fit? How do I make this fit what I need now? Trying to propose is that from the psychology of place, this need to have a place that fits is a constant thing inside of us that propels us towards working with others. And so it's the reparative. It's the how do I have to fix this. I have to fix my society. I actually have to work with other people. So it's moving us towards unity. And as the prayer and lesson that we had at the beginning of this session pointed out to us, towards reconciliation and towards peace. This is a famous quote from Angela Davis, who I admire hugely, but this quote really annoys me. I'm no longer accepting the things I cannot change. I'm changing the things I cannot accept. It's a beautiful piece of rhetoric, but it's playing on the Serenity Prayer. And it's one of those things that's, why does it annoy me? So the Serenity Prayer says, God grant me the serenity to accept the things I cannot change, the courage to change the things I can, and the wisdom to know the difference. So it says the courage to change the things I can. So you can change anything you think you can change. You know, you can't change the wind, you can't change the past, but change whatever you think you can change. It's not inhibiting at all. So why riff on it? And the riff is because partly what has to happen as we build political movements is to help people understand and focus their anger, their energy, and to come together. But there's a downside to this. This very sweet post by Anthony Rella, who was reflecting on Angela Davis's beautiful quote, points out that no matter how powerful anger makes us feel, it's exhausting to be angry and guarded all the time. So we have to act, because that's powerlessness is a significant feature of severe mental health disorders, which can lead to a complete surrender of agency. So we don't want that, but we can't feel anger all the time. And yet, in a way, our sense of place puts us in irritation with our place all the time. And the more we are torn apart, the more we're fractured, the more we're deprived of the kind of comfort of community, the more we will feel all of these things which undermine our health, our ability to work together, and our ability to solve the problems that confront our ecosystem. So here's where gratitude comes in. And just Google gratitude and you get all of these entries, why is gratitude good? Many, many people will tell you why. But what I want to tell you is that gratitude is the reminder that we've pushed to the background of our minds the things we like about the moment. And remembering gratitude, remembering those things that we like, allows us to calm down, allows us to sleep at night, allows us to have some balance. So it doesn't take away, it energizes us. We are exhausted if we're just going to be angry and irritated all the time. Hence, we need this balance of gratitude. And so just to leave you with a sort of a gratitude moment. My colleagues and I, a number of organizations, work together in a project called 400 Years of Inequality. So in 1619, the first Africans landed at Jamestown to be sold into bondage. And so 2019 was the 400th anniversary of that. And our project called for organizations across the nation to observe the anniversary. So a dance group that had created a thing called the Cotton Series put on their dance at the new school, which interestingly enough was also celebrating its centennial. So this became part of the new school centennial and part of the 400 years of inequality observances in 2019. And I'd like you, you may see it towards the left, a little girl in white. Just watch the little girl. So with that, I'd like to stop the share and have questions or conversation or, yeah, whatever you're feeling right now. Thank you for your attention.
All right. Thank you very much. Very, 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 what's the word to use? Insightful. I use the word insightful because there's a lot of things I didn't know. But just a reminder before I continue. Thank you very much. Just want to thank you. And also, people, you guys can send me your questions in the chat if you want to, or doctor, if you want to read the questions yourself out loud and answer them, you can do that as well. Feel free. I'm just a moderator, so.
Yeah. Well, I see one question. What examples have you seen of those that architects and planners have made strides to reverse the impacts of historical racist practices in the built environment? And I think that interestingly, this year there has been, probably growing over the last couple of years, but this year there's been some real movement, I think, in what might be a precondition, which to embrace that the extent to which there have been racist practices. So for example, the American Institute of Architects identified key areas in which the Institute needed to work. And one of them had to do with undoing racial inequality. So I think that that's a very direct and very powerful statement in the architecture profession. Similarly, the New York Regional Plan Association, very powerful organization in the New York metropolitan area, has been doing a lot of work, is planning to, for example, do a podcast series looking at racist practices and how the Regional Plan Association is part of that. They've played a very powerful role in instituting harms. So owning the harms is, I think, a very first step. As with this concept, we are all treaty people. It's a first step towards reconciliation.
There's a question. It says, in this difficult moment, what can planners do to build a stronger society?
In this difficult moment, I mean, I don't want to speak for planners in Canada. I'm not speaking about Canada, so I would hesitate to answer that question for Canada, but I'll speak about the United States. I actually think the same task is before every single person in our society, which is that we are shattered beyond coherence. And so rebuilding bonds is the number one priority. And that means reaching out to others. It means it means finding every single way in which we can, in which we say to people, we are one society, we say to each other, we say to ourselves, and bring down the rage and hostility that are flourishing. One of the things that you read in the newspapers every day is about death threats. Everybody who's in the public eye is receiving death threats, election officials, public health officials, government officials. It's terrifying. So we have to begin to assert that we would like to be a moral nation in which people have a right to live and thrive.
Okay. There's another question. It's what skills does the planning education need to focus on to promote racial justice in the US or in Canada?
Again, I don't know about the situation in Canada, but in the United States, the planning profession has been very much the architects of many kinds of harms. They were the architects of urban renewal. They were architects of disinvestment programs. They were the architects of many of these things. So planners work for the government, and the government is doing these things. So I think that planners have to learn how to manage from below so that they manage the government in a way that it's not destroying the nation.
Okay. There's another question. This is from Catherine. She's super interested in the relationship between repair versus new in architecture and its potential to have an active role in mending societal fractures. And the question, I guess, is this too much of a stretch?
I assume by repair, you mean the repair of old buildings to bring them to new uses versus building new buildings. And you know, certainly ecologically, making use of everything as long as we can is what we have to do if we're gonna continue to have human life on Earth. And we should avoid new as much as we can. On the other hand, redoing the old under the redlining paradigm is the same as building new. So gentrification is often about rehabbing old buildings, but therefore, because it's investment, it's not for poor people, it's for white people with money, whoever white people are. White, constantly moving the definition of white in the United States. So not the same as it was in the 1930s when the first redlining maps were made. Mm-hmm. So it might not be the same. I mean, it might be just as bad, so there are parts of it, if you rehab old buildings, that are good, but there are parts of it that keep the redlining paradigm moving forward.
Thank you. Clary, and I'm sorry if I'm pronouncing anyone's name wrong. So Clary stated that they loved the video. And the idea of joy, and it makes them wonder about the use of joy as a means of resistance, especially in the era of fear tactics. Do you have any thoughts or examples of how this is done in a professional setting or discipline of the built environment?
You mean the promotion of joy?
Yeah, as a tool of resistance.
Yeah, I think it's infinite. Mm-hmm. And our project, 400 Years of Inequality, which called for observances, there were 148 organizations that shared with us what they were planning to do. We know that there were many hundreds of more observances around the nation. And they did all kinds of things, from bell ringing to dances to plays to films to concerts. An example of joy that I really liked was a group of artists went out and did concerts for people who were waiting in line to vote. So it's just the limit is the limit of the human imagination. You know, Freud pointed out that there's a basic contradiction in human beings between our drive for life and our drive for death. And so I think that, you know, in a nation where there are death threats, where there's an armed invasion of the Capitol, false allegations of stealing an election, a president who tweeted by the New York Times count, perhaps as many as 10,000 threats in a 5-year period, death has gotten way out of proportion in our national life. And so how do we balance that? How do we move back towards life is very, very pressing issue.
Thank you. Elaine asked, do you think we need to go to other groups such as investors, developers, tenants, so i.e. users of the real estates to help them understand the implications of some of these issues?
I think we need to go to everybody and help them understand the implications of these issues. We need as many people as possible who will help to remake society to get busy doing that. And part of the remaking is that we have to remake society in a way that's not killing the larger ecosystem which supports human life. That needs everybody to be involved.
Just a follow-up question from me. How do you deal with the people who kind of push back on those kind of, in these kind of movements, in the sense that there is a difficulty in accepting that this is a status quo and this is where we are today and we need to change? How do you just accept that you can't change the things as Angel Davis said, or do you try to push for them to understand this, that there's a need for change?
Not everybody gets with the program at the same time. Mm-hmm. And you don't know exactly when the tipping point is gonna come. And so you do have to kind of let people come along at their own pace. There are a lot of people who are ready to go. So you start with them and then each one bring one, right? Each one teach one. The great urban reform movement, which according to my teachers was started in the 1840s, doesn't really begin to change the American city and make decent housing and safe working conditions, but really until the early 1900s. So that's a 70-year period of struggle, but which is ultimately very transformative. So we have to keep in mind that these struggles are not short, but they can succeed.
Thank you. David asked, I gotta ask this question quickly before they get removed from the chat. David asks, are some Americans and Canadian planners also motivated by xenophobia and financial benefits? And if so, how can those planners who are more community-minded influence their colleagues? And he also states that he loved the comment that we are right in different ways, but are all in the same boat.
Yeah, Martin Luther King said we came up, but we're all in the same boat now. This is about it's really there is a moral question here, but also there's this life versus death question. So greed ultimately in the context of these times is about death. And joy and sharing are about life. And so it's partly that people fall in love with death. And how do you coax them back? And partly it's that the people who love life have to show that it's such a good time and that they're so welcoming of those who are enamored of death that they want to come back. So it has to start, I'm sure, many architects in the audience have read the story of the first house, which apparently in the book I read, was that lightning struck a pile of brush in a forest and made a fire. And the people came out of their caves and gathered around the fire. And they had such a good time being warm and being together that they decided to build houses around the fire. And that's how the first house got started. So it's a little bit like that. How do we light the fire so that people will come out of their caves and enjoy being with each other and build new houses and we can work together?
Thank you. Give me a second, let me just click through all of them. All right, so.
Can I ask a question in the meantime?
Go for it.
So I have an urban design background and let's just say I've been in school a lot. And from my experience with school, I think that the assumption with respect to being a practitioner is that you're practicing with the foregone conclusion that what you're doing is amoral. So it's not immoral or moral, you're just sort of working in this vacuum of morality not really being a question. And I think when you start to sort of address some of the outcomes of practitioners of the things that we do, you begin to see that it begins to raise questions about whether we are in fact practicing in this sort of amoral arena. And I guess I'm wondering how we can sort of start to question that in the level of academics and make it okay for us to actually ask deeper questions about the outcomes of the things that we're doing as practitioners.
Well, I think one of the things on your side is that architects, not so much planners, but architects really in the United States, architects in the United States are some of the most ecologically aware people in our society. And in the crisis of the environment that we're in, they're very aware of it. And there's nobody who's outside the crisis. There's nobody who's outside the crisis of global warming. There's nobody who's outside the crisis of mass extinction, which might include our species. So I think that you want to use that strength, that people have enough science training, they have enough understanding of complexity to get ecological thinking and to say, well, we're not outside this, therefore, how do we act? Which doesn't make it moral. You don't have to say, is it moral? Is it amoral? Is it immoral? Just say, is this sustainable? And a society that's driving the organization of people towards the collection is not sustainable. So I think that is not so true about Canadian society as it is about American society, but there are other kinds of ways in which you can harm a society. And Canada has not been entirely free of the ravages of neoliberalism. So I think asking, is this sustainable? Is this practice gonna help us stay alive as a species, gonna help all the other species stay alive? Is the way in. Just a thought.
Thank you. Thank you for the question, Yumi. We have MJ asked, you share with us as an elder with great wisdom from a life of learning, thinking, working, someone who has contributed to our understanding of how we order ourselves. Can you speak to how your ideas have changed over time or how being at where you are in life shapes what you believe needs to be our priority?
I'm a mother, a grandmother, and a great-grandmother. So your children, your grandchildren, and your great-grandchildren teach you a lot of things that you didn't know. Life teaches you a lot of things that you didn't know. And crisis forces you to reconsider. When we were working in Harlem and describing the nonsense that we were seeing in the neighborhood, we didn't imagine. I mean, we knew the society was being cut, but we didn't imagine the kind of nonsense that we've seen over the past year. So I think one has to be very present for one's times and constantly ask, is what I think what I'm actually seeing? And I think connecting with people younger than oneself is very essential because they just know so much stuff that I don't know. So those, yes, I've been very influenced and my ideas are constantly changing because I try to pay attention to what's going on and I hang out with my family.
This is kind of like a, I mean, you've been giving your answers as well, but I'm very interested to know, I guess I'll start with a preface, I guess. So the states in Canada are different, but also similar. So you spoke about the story about segregation and also the redlining, and this kind of brought a lot of similarities to what happened in Halifax or in Nova Scotia itself, especially in North Halifax and Africville, and how there was systematic planning that pushed the Black community there to kind of disperse. And I use the word disperse in a nice way, if it can be any nice way. Where my question is, I find that the difference with Americans and Canadians is Americans face the racism and the issues head on and deal with it day to day. But Canadians tend not to, and I'm generalizing here, not to accept the bare fact that things like this happen in their own communities. Do you think that with so much trauma that has happened with these Black communities, that they should happily or not would or warmly open their arms to talking to the opposite side and trying to deal with issues that are plaguing them? Because I don't think it's a one side fix the other thing, or I think it's like a community thing. It's kind of a complicated question, if you can answer it. It's just in my head.
Yeah. It seems to me important that people have to excavate their own stories, whatever they are. And then the second thing is that as they excavate them, they have to find the ways to share the stories. And I think it makes a big difference. I had the opportunity to spend a number of years learning about the story of the Hill District in Pittsburgh, which I wrote about in my book, Booth Talk. And with their permission to share that story. And then the book Root Shock helped the city of Pittsburgh to understand the ways in which it had trashed the Black community. And I think it made a big difference. That doesn't mean the struggle is over, but it changed the terms. So I just recently read an article about the state of community benefits and working to repair some of the ways in which the neighborhood had been torn apart, which are very much a conversation between the Hill District and the city and the developer. So that became possible because people shared their stories and insisted that there be a conversation. I think it's the same thing with First Nations people, that that everybody is learning the stories. I don't know if this is politically correct to say in Canada, but I'm a huge fan of Anne of Green Gables. I always have been all my life. And I love the Netflix series, Anne with an E. I couldn't believe they canceled it. But I thought bringing in the story of the First Nations family and the girl who was torn away added a dimension to it that was really profound. So for me, it was really helpful to see that added in. I think we have to add all these stories. It helps us.
Thank you very much. I hope this is not a call out, but Kate, do you want to ask your question? Oh, never mind. She wrote it down. So she was wondering if you could speak to the role of memory within architecture as a mechanism of strengthening society as you defined it. Can nonsensical memory perpetuate nonsense? How can architecture help societies move out of states of nonsense, and does memory play a role in it?
Well, the state of nonsense is the timescale at which architecture works, and the timescale at which, if we can, we should heal nonsense are different timescales. So I would not look to architecture to heal this. I just think it's sort of more, architecture does many things. For example, architects, in the United States, one of the programs of the American Institute of Architects, where I had the honor of serving on the board of the Institute as a public director, and I'm an honorary member of the Institute, so hence that's how I know about them. One of the things they do are send teams to neighborhoods or places that have experienced disaster and help them rebuild in whatever way is possible. In one film that I saw of this program, they built a park in a neighborhood that had been destroyed by a tornado, you know, and sort of in a two-week visioning and quick response. So if you think about what are the roots of white nationalist rage in the United States, it has one source of it is communities that have been abandoned by decent jobs and where there is a lot of drug addiction and many deaths of despair. Could not architects and planners send out teams like all across the US this spring to say, let's visit an array of communities and find out how this rage and how this fracturing has been created. And let's in that way research what needs to be done. That would be on the timescale of the crisis. And I think a phenomenal way in which architects and planners could help.
Thank you so much. Thank you, Kate, for that question. It's 8 o'clock. How long are we supposed to go to, Lisa?
We had planned an hour, but if you have more questions and if Mindy is still available, can keep going. But are there more?
Does anyone want to ask questions?
Yeah. Any other questions?
I shall speak for you if you don't want to speak out loud yourself.
There seem like a lot of questions in the chat. I haven't been able to read them.
But... a lot of comments, yeah. And a lot of like, yeah.
Great.
So there's a good conversation too. Yeah, well, I guess if there are no more questions, I want to thank you, Mindy, so much for joining us. And there's a lot to think about. I think you hit the nail right on the head in terms of thinking about our practice as a form of resistance. Yeah, you see?
There is one last question, actually. Okay.
We'll get one last one in.
Yeah, so HD asked, I have always observed differences in parks and playgrounds in various communities. How does urban planning shape the childhood experience and inequality in a social context?
Well, you know, you have to walk the question back. So when you've, in the United States, when you've created stratification and the stratification drives the assignment of resources, everything follows. So some neighborhoods will become highly resourced and have beautiful parks that are well cared for, and other neighborhoods won't have parks at all. People have done studies of the tree cover now of neighborhoods that were redlined in the 30s. And so the poorest neighborhoods don't have trees. They also don't have a lot of other things. They're food deserts, they're bookstore deserts, they're bank deserts, and they're tree deserts. People have calculated 5 to 10 degrees hotter in those neighborhoods. So if you get back to the point at which segregation gets instituted and the stratification is used to drive resources, and then redlining is added over that, which intensifies the stratification, then nothing has been done since to undo that paradigm. The question becomes, how do we undo that paradigm? And then that becomes an issue of life versus death. Do we choose to create a society in which everybody can live, or are we endorsing death of huge numbers of our own species, extinction of many other species, perhaps the extinction of our own species? Which way are we gonna go? So with that thought, I think that's what's really on the table. And I think architects are some of the people who have articulated this as well as anybody, certainly in American society. That's what's on the table, and life versus death, what are you gonna choose?
Thank you. Just a quick house question. Lisa, Is the recording available to registrants?
Yes, it will be. So we're working on creating a YouTube channel to store all of the event recordings. So yeah, those will be available with, this one, I guess, with Mindy's permission. But the other ones are definitely going to be available. Yeah.
All right, perfect. Thank you very much. No more questions.
Okay. It's really done this time.
Yeah. I don't want to promise.
Thank you so much again, Mindy. A lot to think about. We really appreciate you being here. And thanks to everyone for joining us. I do want to remind everyone that this lecture series is going to continue with speakers and panels through March. And our next event is on February 24th. And we're going to be hosting architect and scholar, Dr. Vernal Newell, who is an assistant professor at the University of Florida. And she's going to be talking about her work of incorporating traditional Trinidadian cultural design practices with computational making and design, and thinking about the meaning of kind of centering these practices in the field of architecture as a matter of racial justice. And then I want to tell you also that the final event for the series in late March is going to be a panel on fighting institutional racism with Dalhousie's own, Ingrid Waldron, Jennifer Llewellyn, and Frank Palermo. And I think it should be a really interesting conversation. So thank you so much, everyone, and especially Mindy for joining us. And also thank you to the Robert H. Winters Fund for supporting all these events in the series. We hope that you'll all join us for the remaining two events. So thank you and have a good night.
Thank you, Lisa. Thank you, Mindy.